हाँ चलो, वेरी गुड आफ्टरनून। हाँ विल स्टार्ट टुडेज क्लास। या सो होप थिंग्स आर क्लियर, वॉइस इज क्लियर एंड ऑडिबल। गुड, ओके। सी नाउ बिफोर आई स्टार्ट विथ टुडेज प्रेजेंटेशन, वी विल हैव अ क्विक रिकैप ऑफ व्हाट we had discussed in the last class. So if you remember, I had told you about Bereta Cup, okay? And Bereta Cup, almost 45 minutes we have exclusively dedicated to the mind part of Bereta Cup. It's a very important remedy. Every remedy is important, provided you understand it well. And only if you understand the remedy well, you can apply that remedy in your clinical practice tomorrow. Okay? So the key is you need to understand the remedy first. Okay? So can we have the quick recap? Yes. Many of you have already started contributing. Okay. See, the key word when we talk of Bereta mind is that they are dwarf. Somebody beautifully have written there, dwarf both physically and mentally. So mind, you see a lot of dwarfness, lot of slowness. Yes, they're very childish. They have issues with confidence. They have issues with memory. They are foolish. They're idiotic. Yeah, very good. Absent-minded. Good, good. So I'm happy you have got a clear picture of Bereta. So if Bereta mind is clear, then we will talk of another component of brain, yeah? Sorry, another component of Bereta. Too many online classes, so the remedies. Okay. So the other component of Bereta cup. So now what next 40 minutes we will try to understand is, we'll try to understand the introductory part of brain, yeah? I don't know why the word brain is coming up. The introductory part of Bereta. Okay. So Bereta, I'll try to tell you under the sphere of action, and we'll look at the ailments from, and hopefully, if time permits, we'll also talk of the characteristic symptoms. Hope I am clear with what I'm going to do today. So Bereta cup, I'll just give you the basic introduction, which practically may not be very useful, but as a third year student, you should know that barium carb is the common name of Bereta carb. It's a mineral source. It is prepared from trituration, and this is very, very important. It is a deep-acting polycrest remedy. Okay, so this is a very important line that you need to remember. Many times, because of we not understanding Bereta, we limit Bereta only to a child. Okay, and probably at the end of the class, you will realize Bereta can be a beautiful remedy indicated for various other complaints. Okay, so it's a polycrest remedy, that is the keyword. And as a third year student, you should also slowly get used to miasms, a very integral part of homeopathy, the organon. And in organon, they will teach you about miasms. Okay, so miasms, which is the predominant miasm in Bereta cup? See, in Bereta you can see psora, in Bereta you can also see psychotic manifestations, and of course the syphilitic manifestations. When you look at the drug picture, when you understand the drug picture, what stands out? You have psora. Yes, psora is the basic miasm. You have psora, I don't deny psora, but what is it that is predominant? That is the reason I have very carefully used the word predominant miasm. The predominant miasm in Bereta is psychosyphilitic. Okay, learning Materia Medica using miasms is again a beautiful understanding. Fine. If miasms are started in organon, then you will understand this part much much better. Okay. So we'll go ahead. Now this again, you know, is a very integral component of any remedy that we learn. Now what is it that I am trying to tell you here is, I already gave you a clue that baryta is a polycrest remedy. Baryta is a deep acting remedy. Now in this component, I am trying to touch that area. Now what is that area that we are trying to look at is sphere of action and pathogenesis of baryta. Me having already shown you this image, many of you have started answering. Many of you, I'm not locked the room. Why many of them are waiting? Okay, one second, let me see. Admit. Okay, chalo. So now what I want you to understand is, yes, many of you have given me the right answer, that the image is showing the affinity of baryta, that baryta has an affinity for glands. It is a glandular remedy. Beautiful. Many of you have come with that, and it's a remedy which has a tendency to affect the glands. Few students have also given me that right word, scrofulous diathesis. Okay, very good. Now we are going a step ahead. As what we have done in the previous classes, we are not just stopping at glands. We are looking at, or we are trying to get a little more clarity. Now what is that clarity I am trying to give you here is, we are looking at two areas here. Glands, yes, absolutely right, it's a glandular remedy. Now second important sub question that comes up here is, which glands? Baryta might affect all these glands in general, but when you're looking at the specific part, baryta is mainly affects the tonsils, the cervical lymph nodes, the prostate, the testes, the uterus and the ovaries. If you're looking at a very specific area. But in general, baryta is a glandular remedy and having a special affinity for tonsils, cervical group of lymph nodes, the male genitalia, the testes, the female, the ovaries and of course the prostate. Now what is the next question? What will baryta do acting on these glands? Now this is where the miasm plays a beautiful role. Okay, now it is not simple inflammation. If it is inflammation, you know it is psora, and inflammation should be there. That is the basic miasm. Somebody has told ulceration. If it is ulcers, it will be syphilitic. Now what did I tell you? It is more of psychosyphilitic. Now this is the beautiful usage of miasmatic knowledge with materia medica. Now as a psychosyphilitic remedy, what do you see in baryta is, acting on glands, it will cause induration. It will cause swelling and the glands get indurated. Indurated means what? Again, knowledge of pathology. Induration means hardening. Very good. Good. So this slide tells you about the action of baryta on glands, specifically on which glands and what exactly is the result of baryta acting on these glands. I hope this is clear. See, I'm going slow, I'm going very methodical and systematic so that you don't miss. The only problem we have when we go slow, so slow and methodically, the problem is time. We'll try to compensate taking extra classes, but let's not compromise on the quality of teaching and learning. Okay, so the second area, first, mind you, we just discussed is glandular affinity, and second, see the other important vital organ Barrett affects. Okay, see now if you look at the Barrett carp, if you look at Barrett carp from Wikipedia or some of the online sites, Barrett carp is a muscular poison. Mainly it poisons the muscles of the heart. Okay, now in proving what exactly you have in Barrett carp, it is a cardiovascular poison. It acts on the muscle coat of the heart and the vessels. Very, very important. Now, what is it causing? Acting on the coat of the blood vessels. It will cause the blood vessels to soften. The poisonous effect will soften and the blood vessels can go into degeneration. Okay? The result of which will be that, you know, the vessels will dilate, it will get distended. And this, as a third year student, from your surgery knowledge, you know, we call this term as aneurysm. Okay? Abnormal dilatation of the artery. So the arteries will get distended and it will get dilated. Aneurysm. Very important condition. And homeopathy has few very important remedies for this condition. And one remedy is Barrett. Okay, I don't know if you have heard of aneurysm. You might be too young. I wanted to ask you this question: which are all the other remedies for aneurysms? Aneurysm. Mainly we have lycopodium. Yeah, I know. When heart comes, Cactus digitalis come. Very good. I'm happy that you are thinking of Cactus and digitalis. But you also have to understand the beauty of homeopathy. When Cactus in heart affections, when digitalis in heart affections, when Barrett in heart affections. Now this is the clarity you need to get. If you get this clarity, then homeopathy will be very, very, very interesting and very beautiful to explore. Okay, good. As a third year student, when I talk of heart, you are thinking of Cactus, you are thinking of what? You are thinking of digitalis. I'm happy. But the next important learning process is when Cactus, when digitalis, when Lyco, when Aurum, when Barrett. So I have taken this slide, and you know this slide gives you a lot of clarity. Why there is aneurysm in Barrett? Now this is the pathogenesis. How Barrett causes aneurysm, or why Barrett causes aneurysm in you know, what is the cause for aneurysm in Barrett? This is the explanation given in our Materia Medica books. Okay, I've taken from those books and I'm trying to explain so that tomorrow when you come across aneurysm, you know this is the pathophysiology that is happening behind Barrett, and this is why aneurysms will result. Lycopodium can be a very good remedy for aneurysms. Very good. You also have Aurum. You also have many carbons, carbobase, carboanimalis, graphitis. They can be calcareous, very good. They can be few remedies for aneurysm. Okay. See, as a third year student, you should start thinking of other remedies. We'll not try to differentiate. Probably that will try to take it up in final year. Okay. But as a third year student, you should know the first step, which are all the other remedies. If you know the other remedies, then comparison will become easy and interesting. Okay, so we'll go ahead. This will cause aneurysm and it might also result in stroke. It might also result in apoplexy, which is nothing but stroke. So now how stroke happens is what I've tried to explain step by step. Cardiovascular poison acts on the muscle cords. The muscle vessel, blood vessels become soft, degenerated, followed by dilatation of the vessels, aneurysm, followed by stroke. Okay, I hope things should be clear for you. Another aspect also, many of you are contributing. Barrett is again a very good remedy for atherosclerosis. Good, acting on blood vessels. Barrett can cause accumulation of all those fatty things. Fine. accumulation of cholesterol. A psychotic remedy, you can also think of Bereta in atherosclerosis. Okay. Yeah, this we should not miss. We have focused so much on heart. The next area Bereta can equally affect will be the central nervous system. Okay. Acting on the nerves, Bereta will cause paralysis. See, never neglect the sphere of action. How nicely you understand sphere of action, so easy the particular symptoms will become. Because it is the particular symptoms will be an extension of sphere of action. It will be an application of sphere of action. So this is very important. See, many times we give more importance to the mental symptoms. Yes, mind is definitely important. But mind and body, there are two parts. So to understand this part, it's very important to focus on the sphere of action. So a quick recap, what were the areas where Bereta acts, sphere of action? Can I have some inputs? So the main action will be on the glands, very good. And acting on the, see, now don't stop on glands. You'll have to extend the statement, acting on the glands, it will cause what? It will cause, induration. A sub question can be which glands? Yes. Then the second question is heart, blood vessels. Yes. And the third area, or the fourth area we saw is it also acts on the nervous system. Okay. Any quick questions? If at all you have any questions, please feel free to ask. I'll just take up any questions. Yeah, I'm happy. I was just going through the chat box. Yes. Good. All of you have contributed the right answers. Congratulations. We'll go ahead. So the first component we complete here is sphere of action and pathogenesis. Now the second component that we will be taking up will be ailments from. Okay. This again a very interesting component of Bereta or any remedy. So we will look at the ailments from. What are the causative factors of Bereta? Now to start with, this image tells so much about Bereta's ailment from. Yes, they are very sensitive to cold. Okay, these constitutions, see, there are few constitutions who have a tendency, to catch cold very easily. And Bereta is one such remedy who can't take cold easily. They can't tolerate cold. So exposure to cold can be a simple ailment of Bereta. And I wanted to ask this question, but then the next slide quickly came up. Now, which are all the other remedies which have a tendency to catch cold very easily? Who are the other constitutions? Very good, pulsatilla. Okay, could be pulsatilla. Yes, a better remedy is dulcamara. Somebody has told natrum phos. I have a small change there. A better remedy will be natrum sulf rather than natrum phos. Okay, antimtart, heparsulf, beautiful, good. Yes, as a third year student, you have tried to get in a good number of remedies. Aconite is also a remedy that you should remember. And of course, few which are not there in your third year syllabus, like sorainam, tuberculinum, these are few more things you need to remember. So exposure to cold is a causative factor. And now can somebody quickly tell me what is this? This was the most decent picture I could get it on the internet. Very good. Bad effects of masturbation. Good. So Bereta also has a second causative factor, which is masturbation, bad effects of masturbation. Now, before we look into what happens in Bereta because of masturbation, can I have some more remedies from your side, which you are aware for bad effects of masturbation? Homeopathy has a set of remedies, very good. The speed is what makes me feel proud and happy. Yes, Staphysagria, beautiful. I mean, the moment I said bad effects of masturbation, I can't see the name here, but one of your friend quickly contributed Staphysagria. Okay, it should be Ayman if I'm right. Yes, and then we also have Roshini, Sai, lot of other people contributing. Ullas, Pragati, fine, good. See, now one top remedy that should come to your mind when you have a male, when you have a female who comes to you for help, and then she's got some issues related to masturbation. Okay. So we'll not debate if masturbation is good, bad, and all. We'll not look into that area in today's class. We are just trying to understand the remedies for bad effects of masturbation, and what is that will happen in Bharata because of masturbation. Okay. Now each of these remedies that you have contributed will have its own set of symptoms. Okay. But what will a Bharata patient come to you with? For example, if you have a patient who is complaining of dyspepsia or who is complaining of indigestion, and he would have observed, I know he is a Bharata, but then he would have observed that every time he masturbates, he will have issues with indigestion. He will have issues with digestion. Okay, and then there is indigestion. The only remedy our Materia Medica has is Bharata. I hope you understand the seriousness of this symptom. It's very easy. Tomorrow somebody comes to your clinic, they have indigestion, and they tell you it's got nothing to do with food, it's got nothing to do with stress. Doctor, I have observed something very peculiar, and I have seen this every time I masturbate, I'll end up with indigestion. The only remedy, no system on this earth can help this particular patient except homeopathy. And even in homeopathy, the only remedy we have is Bharata cup. Okay. Similarly, you have another very important question. You have another very important situation that is coming up here. Pain in heart, pain in the region of the heart. And again, an observation made by a Bharata patient is only after masturbating, the pain aggravates. Now, many of your friends are asking this question. Sir, how do you ask? I know it's a very private area. How do you ask? Yes, especially gastric symptoms coming up after masturbation. You can't ask every patient who comes to you with gastritis, you can't ask this question. Okay? You can't ask this question. Now, yes, how do you question this is again a very important part. See, these are all very sensitive areas. And we generally directly don't ask such questions. Okay? Now, I can just give you some practical hints. Many times, it is the patient who comes up with such symptoms. At least create an environment where patient feels free to share such things with you. Okay? Don't create an awkward situation, or don't make him feel abnormal. At least give him room. Give him that kind of confidence that you can share even such personal things with you. Okay? So that kind of environment is what you need to create. Or when you are looking at the obvious causes of indigestion, so there is no change in food, there is no stress, that you don't see any obvious cause for indigestion. Probably, in a very decent way, you can put it across this question. Have you seen something like this, you know, when you masturbate, something like this happening? Fine. These are all very, very difficult and very sensitive areas. I repeat this, but you have to learn the art of questioning. Okay. That's what I'm trying to tell you. Please don't make it ugly. It's all your capacity. It is all how you put the question across and with what dignity you question, all those things play a very important role. Probably you will get this with experience. Okay, fine. I hope I have given you some clarity. I know I can't give full justification, but at least I have tried to make an attempt. Okay, so that, you know, creating an environment, the way you ask, you are a doctor, fine. The way you ask, the patient should never feel ashamed. The patient should never feel ugly. It is the way you question, the patient should feel, yes, must be, it is normal. That is the kind of situation you have to create, and that is when you have to question. Okay, so masturbation leading to indigestion, masturbation leading to heart pain in heart, not heart attack, nothing great, just simple pain, cardialgia, we call it as, you know, that simple pain in that cardiac area. Okay, so we'll go ahead. Hope your questions are answered. Okay, now what were the two ailments that we just spoke? One was about exposure to cold, and second thing was masturbation. Now again, looking at this image, see, this is where I owe so much to Google Images, from where I keep taking the images. The images will create a kind of an atmosphere where you start thinking, what could this image be? Okay, somebody says wet feet, yeah, somebody says foot sweat. Yes, now foot sweat, the ailment in Barata is suppressed foot sweat. Now what do you understand by suppressed foot sweat? A patient had foot sweat, he has taken some treatment or he has applied something, some therapy he has taken, and the feet stop sweating, after which he lands up with some problem. I hope I am clear. Now the question is, what is that problem that a Barata patient comes up after suppressed foot sweat? See, these are all very practical and clinical hints you need to look at. One of your friend has already given the answer. Very good. Padmini says, throat affections, throat complaints, which comes up after suppressed foot sweat, you can think of Barata. Very good. That could be one thing. Or like what we saw in the previous slide, there can be pain in the heart. See, they don't say pain in chest. See, they are very specific. Pain in heart, heart region, pain in cardiac region, or pain in throat, which comes up after suppressed foot sweat, the remedy is Barata cup. Okay, it is not, it may not be as severe as angina. See, in angina, there will be issues with blood circulation and etc. It could be more of a muscular pain. It could be more of a pain. They have not specified if it is anginal pains. Okay, but pain in heart after suppressed foot sweat, or pain in throat after suppressed foot sweat, you can think of Barata. So some interaction here, which are all the other remedies which has ailments from suppressed foot sweat? As a third year student, very good, good, very good. All of you have got it right. Silicea, good. I'm very happy. Silicea is a remedy that should come to your mind when we talk of suppressed foot sweat. Good. Keep it up. I'll add few which I've taken from the repertory, and murk, sorainam, sulfur. These are all few more remedies you should keep in your mind, which has ailments from suppressed foot sweat. Okay. So we'll go ahead. Probably this is the last ailment we have in Barata. What is it that I'm trying to tell you is complaints which comes during extremes of life. Okay, complaints during childhood and complaints during yeah, good, the extended childhood or the second childhood, which we call it as old age. So complaints which comes at extremes of life. Okay, so two components we have discussed. One was sphere of action and pathogenesis. And the second component we are discussing here is ailments from. Okay, so any questions? Ailments from, you have five. I'll just quickly repeat those five from where we had stopped. Extremes of life was one, and then we also have suppressed food sweat. Then we also have exposure to cold, or we also have bad effects of masturbation. Okay, I hope this is clear. Fine. So we will quickly, disconnect. We'll unlock, and again we'll rejoin. And in the next thing, I'll be talking to you about the characteristic symptoms. Okay. So if you have no questions, we will leave the meeting and we'll get back. Thank you.